So the next topic here is creation versus evolution. This is on your website from Norman Geisler, NGIM. Here are some topics I guess you guys speak on, and it says creation versus evolution. So what is your main point on there?
Well, basically what we were talking about, that there is evidence of intelligent design, that when we look at nature, we see there are goals everywhere in nature, that the electron is four electric charges, it's four balancing an atom, your eye is four seeing, the heart is four pumping blood, space is four housing matter, that you have evidence of a mind, that the DNA is information. All of this points to there's got to be a mind that is actually behind the design, that we're going to say that natural causes do not have full explanatory power, that the reason why math is possible, logic is possible, is because we live in a logical reality, because as I was saying earlier, God is identical to reality. God is reality. God is existence. I'm in existence right now, and existence itself is logical. Laws of existence. I can't exist and not exist at the same time. This is why math is possible. I would say that that God's existence, we are in existence. We're in the divine mind, and the reason why reality is intelligible is because God is existence and God is an intellect. I think that has greater explanatory power than naturalism.
Okay, so you are saying, and Norman Geisler, your ministry there, is saying that you are basically anti-evolution as far as you think that humans descending from other animals is a total farce,
right.
It's total unscientific, it's totally wrong?
Right.
I mean, you understand the gravity of that? Like I said, every state university teaches evolution. You're saying every state university, every science department is wrong in what they're teaching.
I'm saying that since the collapse of classical philosophy, we have people who are well-intentioned trying to interpret data who are missing the philosophical toolbox to interpret things properly. That, for example, you have Aristotle in his four causes. You have efficient causality, formal causality, material causes, and final causality. Like, if I said, what caused the house to get built, you would say the builders. If I said, what's causing that to be a house, that would be what we call formal causality. The form of the house is why it's a house. If I said, what caused you to build a house, what would that answer be? What causes you to build a house? It's for what?
For nesting.
Yeah, for shelter, for, you know, protection or whatever. And so final causality and formal causality are almost totally absent in modern science because philosophy has been abandoned.
So you've heard of the Christian organizations, Biologos, and have you heard of
right.
AS? Yes?
Yes, yes.
And also, have you heard of the American Scientific Affiliation, ASA?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so you're saying those are both very friendly and will promote evolution. Evolutionary creationism. So you're saying they are also going off the deep end as Christian groups.
Yeah. Well, I'm saying that. I'm saying that I don't think most people today are taught the philosophy that they need to properly interpret the scientific data. That we can have brilliant guys like Stephen Hawking. You know, Hawking is—he's not an idiot. But when he says things like philosophy is dead, which is a self-defeating statement because he just made a philosophical statement about philosophy. That basically, the average person is just a mere layman when it comes to the area of philosophy, which is key in interpreting the scientific data.
Well, I agree with you that philosophy is dead is a very poor statement, and it basically shows like no comprehension of philosophy. I totally agree with you 100% on that.
But you wouldn't say he's dumb. I mean, he's a brilliant scientist, but he...
I know, but that's not his field. I mean, philosophy is not his field, though.
Yeah.
I won't mention the name, but there's one atheist. It was obvious. I was listening to him in a debate, and he obviously didn't know what deductive and inductive logic even was, and he was going off on it and didn't even know what it was. But it's back to Christianity, though. I mean, you got, like, Francis Collins. he's a Christian, evangelical Christian. Of course, he fully accepts, you know, evolution.
Yeah, and if you see, he is now saying that he's starting to backpedal. I'm saying, I'm using terms like junk DNA, because I think they jumped the gun on that one.
You think Francis Collins is backpedaling as far as accepting evolution?
Not as far as evolution, but things like junk DNA.
BioLogos has an article on this ENCODE project, what you're talking about, and the junk DNA and everything, and so there's a whole nother take on it. I don't know if you're aware of it or not. I mean, are you aware of what BioLogos what they would say against the ENCODE project and what you're trying to claim for it?
About which part?
Well, for example, you say they're finding all these known functions, and for example, in the BioLogos article, they mention how, well, yeah, they know these genes are corrupted copies from something that actually worked, and now they have some other function. And some of these functions are just functions, but they're not really required or necessary functions. Yeah. And the ENCODE project made no differentiation on what was really required or what was just a process.
Like, I have a quote here from, it's on page 57 of the ENCODE project consortium in 2012. It says, these data enabled us to assign biochemical functions for 80% of the genome, in particular outside the well-studied protein coding regions.
That's exactly what I said, though. They're functions, and they didn't differentiate between needed functions and just functions. Some of the functions aren't really needed, but they're still functions.
Like, back to what I was saying about formal causality and final causality, the form of a thing is what it is. It can have a perfected form or an imperfect form. If it's a perfected form, then we have a goal for what it's supposed to be. That's why you can tell an error in the in a protein code shows that it deviated from how it's supposed to be. So we're presupposing that there's supposed to be perfection in there, but only a mind can actually account for a perfect standard or goal when making a protein code.
That's the whole point, though. There is no such thing as what it's supposed to be. There's no such thing as an insulin gene, and this is what it's supposed to be. You can look at how there are errors in proteins.
How do you know if it's an error if you don't know what it's supposed to be?
Well, when you have like pseudogenes, for example, there's start and stop codes, and you can see you need these start and stop codes in order to express the gene correctly. And because they're chopped up, they're not expressed correctly, or if there's a frame shift or something like that, there's some kind of mess up. But as far as the actual code, there's so many different codes you can use to get the same exact DNA sequence, the same exact amino acid sequence. There's so much redundant ways to program it. There's no such thing as an exact code for these amino acids.
But can you recognize an error in the code?
Yeah.
If there's an error, then that means there's a way that it's supposed to be. And the final causality would be the goal of it. What is the goal of that code would be to produce a functioning protein.
Well, part of the problem is you're looking at it like it's either working or it doesn't. And when you look at amino acids, like I said, they can change by one bit. And sometimes even one amino acid in a gene will change and the gene still works. They show this about insulin.
It's a pretty good code.
You can look at the insulin code across different species, and you can see how some of the amino acid sequences changed a little bit, but it still works.
Yeah,
it's a matter of does it still work.
Job.
It's not a matter of a perfect code. It's not a matter of what it's supposed to be. It's just what works. It's good enough, basically.
If there are some errors. But the goal of it is to work. Like, what kind of things set goals? Aim for goals.
That's the whole point, too. There is, in evolution, there is no goal. There is no, like, humans were a goal. I mean,
I know, and that's the problem with evolution. There's goals everywhere in the universe. The fabric of reality itself. There's nowhere we don't see goals. Even the electron itself, like I was saying, we see goals for it. It has purpose. It's there for uniting atoms with other atoms.
Okay.
Purpose is everywhere.
Time's up on that subject. Let's see, we've got 7 more minutes for one more topic.
Okay.